Surprisingly, for all its complexity and highly radioactive and dangerous nature, the universe itself outside Earth actually only has a short list of ways to cause human extinction, as delicate as we are. Typically, we think of this question in terms of the most obvious way, an asteroid impact. That's a big danger, but there are a few other scenarios where some celestial event could cause our demise. One of these is the possibility of a nearby supernova. Now, what defines a near-Earth supernova is the question of whether it could affect Earth's biosphere in some way. Here, it's important to note that much of Earth's raw materials are present because there was once a close supernova that populated the solar system with its heavier materials. But as to how we would be affected today, the supernova would need to be at a distance of less than 1,000 light years to have an effect. In most cases, much less, to do much other than certain very high energy particles linked to supernovas that hit Earth's upper atmosphere on a regular basis. Surprisingly, given the criteria, there actually have been a somewhat alarming number of close supernovae just over the last 11 million years. The number is a whopping 20 supernovae, that close in that short of a time frame. And due to the nature of the movement of stars in the Milky Way, there are going to be more in the future as the Sun makes its way through the galaxy, undergoing countless future stellar encounters, and some will no doubt be dangerous. Really close, highly dangerous supernovae within a distance of just over 30 light years happens on average once every 240 million years. As to the damage they can cause, the primary damage is going to be from gamma rays. In Earth's case, the major damage here would be to the ozone layer. A close enough one would basically strip the ozone layer off, and the Earth's surface would be very rapidly bathed in ultraviolet light from the Sun. This is dangerous to life on Earth, because while obviously skin cancer rates would go through the roof and would have to take precautions when going into direct sunlight, the real threat is to the phytoplankton in the ocean, because these and related ocean life effectively form the base of the oceanic food chain and could be heavily impacted. Knock that food source down, and we have a severe reverberating food chain problem for all macrofauna on Earth. But this equation also depends on the type of near-Earth supernova that might occur, or have occurred in the past. Supernovae are classed types of events, and the classes differ significantly from each other. Most of the speculation done on how bad things could get on Earth after such an event are based on the type 2 supernova, of which there are subclasses. Type 2 supernovae are the most famous type, where a change happens in a giant star's equilibrium as it hits iron on the periodic table, as it fuses its way along the periodic table at the end of its life. This happens to stars that are at least 8 times more massive than the Sun, but interestingly, not more than 40 or 50 times. Above that, there is no supernova at all. The whole thing just collapses into a black hole. The stars that meet this kind of end tend to be young, very massive stars that live short lives, and these types of supernovae are hallmarked by the heavy presence of hydrogen in their spectra. Weirdly, astronomers see these types of supernovae in spiral galaxies like the Milky Way, but not really in elliptical galaxies, which are composed of mostly old, low-mass stars. What happens here is that when the supernova gets to iron and nickel, the fusion output of the core basically stops. Reactions of iron or nickel produce no net energy, so the star's core literally goes inert. This means that there is no degeneracy pressure coming from the star's core to keep the star from collapsing under its own gravity. As it collapses, electron degeneracy pressure is overcome. This is called the Chandrasekhar limit, and the star continues to implode. But that causes the outer core of the star to implode at speeds of 1/5 the speed of light, causing the temperature of the core to rise cataclysmically. But there is a limit. Neutron degeneracy stops the whole process, and the core rebounds. The shockwave from that, along with the high temperatures, allows for a brief period of fusion to occur that produces elements heavier than iron, and basically blows them out into the universe. This type of supernova, if it were close enough, could strip Earth of half its ozone layer if it was within 26 light years. These are estimated to happen about 10 times per billion years, so Earth has been affected in its history by about 45 of these types of supernovae. Life has survived them all during the period it existed, but there actually is a worse type of supernova. This type is known as Type 1A, and this one is tricky because we may not know about it in time to prepare. A type 1a supernova is where you have a binary system consisting of a white dwarf and another type of star, or even another white dwarf. Here the stars are exchanging material, and the white dwarf is accreting material robbed from the second star until it reaches a certain point, and boom. We don't really have a good handle yet on nearby systems hosting white dwarfs in this position, and it could well take us by surprise. But we do have an example for this. In the star system IK Pegasi, at a current 154 light years away, it's estimated that by the time this one goes off, the proper motion of the sun and the star system will have carried it to a safe distance. But it's of course possible that a system like this lurks much more close by that we don't yet know about. As far as type 2 supernovae, we're currently safe. There are candidates, not the least of which is Betelgeuse, that will eventually go supernova, but are too far to do damage, but will present an absolutely spectacular sight to anyone that may still be here when they go off. This list actually includes some of the most prominent stars in the night sky other than Betelgeuse. Also on the list are Antares, Rigel, and Spica, which is the closest other than IK Pegasi at about 250 light years. So what would it be like to watch? Well, let's take Betelgeuse as an example. Betelgeuse is a red supergiant at a distance of about 590 light years. Here the star's core is no longer fusing hydrogen, but that is happening in an outer shell of the core. This means helium, and often helium is fatal to stars. Here the helium is accumulating at high density and will eventually get hot enough to fuse heavier elements. We don't know exactly if Betelgeuse has hit this stage yet, though recent evidence suggests that it hasn't. But when it does, it has only a few hundred more years to live. When it finally explodes, it will leave a neutron star that will probably become a pulsar after a type 2 supernova explosion. Despite the recent dimming event at the star, which had basically belched out a dark cloud, it's probably at least 100,000 years from exploding, perhaps significantly longer. Interestingly, however, there will be an invisible, invisible light flux of material that arrives from Betelgeuse's explosion about 100,000 years after it happens. We're safe from this. The heliopause of the sun will block the flow and it won't be a problem. It's likely getting assaulted by supernova shockwaves as we speak. But we'll give future scientists, if we're still here, a lot to study. We'd see a prolonged X-ray flux to the tune of tens of thousands of years, but these will be blocked by Earth's atmosphere, so we won't know the difference, but it may change the equation for space travel to a degree. Shielding will have to be adjusted. We will also know about this event before we actually see it. Type 2 supernovae like this will produce a pulse of neutrinos warning us to turn the instruments towards it. Its brightness will certainly exceed anything in the night sky except the moon, and if we haven't altered our visual capabilities 100,000 years from now, it's going to be hard to look at that point source that bright. It might even cause damage to your retina. Never stare at a near-Earth supernova the few weeks it's bright. But what of past extinctions related to supernovae? Well, first is the aforementioned population of the solar system by heavier elements produced by a nearby supernova. The evidence for this comes from the presence of long-lived daughter products from the decay of short half-life isotopes, and it has been suggested that the supernova event actually precipitated the formation of the solar system. It's also an open question as to whether elements produced by the supernova were instrumental in abiogenesis on Earth, and that had it not happened, life wouldn't be here, opening up a route for a solution to the Fermi paradox, simply being that you need a nearby supernova to happen that produces the right amount of heavier elements, at just the right time for life to be possible in a star system. At the same time, however, supernovae over long terms are not rare, so it may not be a hard solution to the paradox. But the effects of supernovae outside of that on Earth are not well explored. But there are a few indicators. The isotope iron 60 has been found in Pacific Ocean sedimentary rock deposits. This points to a nearby supernova having occurred about 5 million years ago, or less, because the abundances are high, and otherwise the supernova would have had to have been very close, enough for a mass extinction. But that does not seem to have happened. That's actually at odds with other evidence, however. For the iron 60 deposit to be there, the quantity would still suggest that the supernova was less than 100 light years away, but for one that close, the chances are rather small, only about 5% for the last 5 million years. It has been suggested that the reason for this is that the odds are wrong due to the solar system entering the Orion arm of the galaxy. More recent evidence shows interstellar dust is found in the Antarctic surface snow that's very recent and again shows iron 60, bolstering the case for a near-Earth supernova in the not-too-distant past. But then we get back to the gamma rays, and there we may have some evidence of supernova mass extinctions in Earth's past, specifically the End Ordovician Extinction. This was the first of the really bad ones as far as Earth's extinction events go. It came in two pulses, about a million years apart, starting about 443 million years ago. Earth largely only had marine life at this stage, and only evidence of very primitive plants are associated with land. This mass extinction was horrific, killing 85% of all marine life and altering the course of marine evolution permanently. One possibility is that the initial extinction pulse was caused by a gamma ray burst, but not just any burst of gamma rays from a supernova, but this one from a hypernova. A hypernova is a type of supernova where a very specific and very extreme core collapse happens, resulting in a rotating black hole. But not only that, but also an accretion disk and relativistic jets coming out of the poles ready-made. These things are much more energetic explosions than normal supernovas, and are at least 10 times greater in luminosity. The result of the conditions of a hypernova is a sustained, very long gamma ray burst, which can be on order of 2 minutes in duration. That's a solidly damaging dose of gamma rays for Earth, and worse, a hypernova could do damage at much greater distance. In this case, it could have been as far as 6,000 light years away. That's scary. If this were the case, even just a 10-second gamma ray burst would have almost immediately stripped the ozone layer, like near instantly in this context, and started the extinction in short order due to exposure from ultraviolet light from the sun. Shallow living plankton would have been immediately hit, more so than anything on the seabed, and this would have set off a period of severe glaciation due to the production of nitrogen dioxide, which would have caused global cooling, worsening conditions for extant life on Earth. This is far from a proven hypothesis, but it's a scary one, especially in that if you were alive in those days, you'd probably never even know anything was wrong unless someone had a gamma ray detector. You'd just be having lunch, unaware the ozone layer was being stripped above you by the gamma ray burst, and that a mass extinction was beginning in short order, all caused by something that happened to a star 6,000 years previous. But there's also the strange case of the supernova remnant RxJ0852.0-4622. This is a weird one that was detected in front of a larger supernova remnant, like it's superimposed on it from our line of sight. Gamma rays from the decay of titanium-44 suggest that this supernova happened recently and fairly close. In fact, it's thought that this star exploded at the beginning of the 13th century here on Earth from our perspective. Yet there were plenty of people recording what was going on in the sky at that time across the globe. Yet not a single reference in the historical record indicates anyone even saw this, even though they very well should have, since the distance could have been as close as 650 light years away. This is statistically weird because a supernova that close should happen less than once per 100,000 years. Yet there it is. This remnant needs more study, but it stands to show that we may not know everything about the possibilities of near-Earth supernovae, and perhaps even less about hypernovae. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently eyeing the universe suspiciously again. It sure seems to throw a lot of stuff at us. Ultra-high energy cosmic rays, interstellar meteorites, dinosaur-killing asteroids, and gamma ray bursts. It may be beautiful, but it definitely has a vendetta against us. But it also physically allows candy bars to exist, so it can't all be bad. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.